Welcome to Digital Hospitality. I am your host, Sean Walcha, founder of Cali Barbecue and Cali Barbecue Media. Every business needs to be digital first, and every business needs to be in the hospitality business. We have been doing this podcast since 2017, and one of the things that we love the most is that we get to interview the greatest minds, greatest thinkers, but more importantly, the greatest doers in digital hospitality. Today, we have the founder of GoTab, Tim McLaughlin. Tim, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Sean.
So it's not rare, but it seems to be rare that an entrepreneur finds a problem in one industry and jumps to another industry. Bring us to the problem. Bring us to the idea. What were you doing and how did it come about?
Okay. Oh, since we have a little bit of time, I'm gonna give the little longer version.
Give me the long version. This is long. This is a podcast. The reason we do the podcast is long form stories always are better. We'll cut it for short form so that people across TikTok and LinkedIn can get the abbreviated answers. But let's give one thing I love about our listeners is that they're always in for a good story. So give it to us.
Well, I'll give you my story. I'm an engineer, but I've been writing software since I was a kid. And so I intended to go into software and robotics, ended up going into e-commerce because I graduated college in 2000. And I did e-commerce and content management in the sort of a consulting to the Fortune 500 companies for 12 years. And I ended up building a digital agency of a couple hundred people. And we did consulting for brands across the United States, or global brands, actually. In the hospitality business, Mandarin Oriental was one of my clients globally.
Wow.
We launched their website in 13 languages. So I did that for 12 years, grew into 7 offices. And even though we're headquartered in DC, most of our clients were Chicago, San Fran, New York, LA, and ultimately sold that company. So had enough of it. It was fun, but wanted to do something else.
What year was that? What year did you sell it?
I sold it in 2012.
And so how many employees did you have at the time?
Just under 200, but 190.
Significant.
It was good. It was a very different world.
Yeah, it was the beginning of Web 2.0, kind of.
We started in 2002. So I basically started out of the ashes of .com.
Yep.
And I remember it was a rough time the first 2-3 years.
Convincing people that the internet, it's hard still in 2023 to convince people that the internet's a thing.
For real. In 2002, like, people said, oh yeah, this internet thing, it's kind of like where crypto is now, right?
Yes, like, exactly.
Yeah, that's funny. That was a dumb idea. That's not going forward. I mean, I literally had some dude in 2003, I think, laugh at me and say, and make some comment about how, am I going to need his shirt because, you know, I'm losing mine.
Oh, nice.
I was like, dude, I don't even know you.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of stuff you would get back then. We said, hey, you know, internet's a very valuable marketing tool and you're going to need a website. And so that's actually what we did for 10 years. 2002, we started it and fought our way through to 2012, sold it to a private equity group in LA, and it was good. It was fun. And I hung on for a couple more years, helped to transition to a new CEO, got involved with some other tech companies, made some small investments in the tech space because that's what I knew.
Yep.
But like, my last big client was Goldman Sachs. We built all client facing portal. So if you're a wealth management client, you log into a system. My first company designed all those interfaces. It was a big project. And it's actually now, incidentally, their largest business unit. So did that sort of on a whim. A friend of mine said, okay, you sold your company. Now, what are you going to do? And he said, well, I think you should build a bar. And I was like, yeah, I'm definitely not doing that.
my kind of friend.
Right, exactly. But what ended up happening is in Virginia, where I live, the laws changed around breweries, and breweries are allowed to sell direct to consumer out of the tap room. And this is when those laws were kind of craft brewery laws were changing around the country.
Yep.
And so you start seeing tap rooms pop up as a thing in Virginia. And that happened in 2012, happened to be the year I sold my company. And I'm a cyclist. I live on a bike trail. And cycling and craft beer go together really, really well. And turns out a lot of people who love to cycle love craft beer. And so I kind of said, okay, another friend of my buddy, a friend of mine exited his company and he's like, well, I'll co-found it with you. And so what ended up happening is I said, well, let's finance this thing. If we can find a space right on the bike trail with a patio, I'll bankroll it. Let's make it happen. So we opened it, became a pretty rapidly a go-to place in my town here in Vienna, Virginia. About 2.2, 2.3 million, is about 3,000 square feet, including the brewery. It's a full service restaurant.
2.2 million revenue? Annual,
yeah, 2.2 yeah. annual revenue. We were really focused on premise, which was
some food also. Was it food also? What was the split? What was the split?
About 60% food, 40% beverage. It would fluctuate some, but we were trying to do something a little higher end than you see on the East Coast. On the West Coast, you see, you know, places like Stone where they're full service and high quality food and whatnot. You don't see a lot of that on the East Coast. And we're foodies and beverage people. And so we said, well, let's make something that actually has really good food, not just, you know, counter service hamburgers and fries, which I will admit was not super well received by the market around here. That's when I learned to hate Yelp like everybody else in restaurants.
What year was this? Bring us to the, what year did the
opening? So we opened the first restaurant in 2015.
Okay.
So I was, you know, I was involved, pretty involved, but it was not my only job. I was still working, exiting SiteWorks and doing some other tech stuff. In 2015, we opened our doors, quickly realized, you know, we're basically at capacity because you don't do a lot of takeout beer, right? You can, but then you start doing distribution and it's a very different structure than say takeout food. So we're max capacity. We had a parking limitation and a bunch of stuff like that. So we really just couldn't get any bigger. And then in 2016, a year after I opened, I don't think I even named it yet, GoTab. I think actually maybe I had. I actually had, now that I think of it, it was trademarked and filed. And the goal was, hey, pay your check faster, just so I can get people out of my restaurant faster so that I can get more people sitting down and drinking beer, right? That was the goal. So that happened in 2016. It was simultaneous to the breweries and the other things. And I was still, I was on it, but I wasn't 150% like I am now on it. And then essentially we started playing with it. We didn't see the uptake. This was pre-QR, I guess 2016. QRs didn't become supported on the iPhone until 2017, which basically meant they weren't useful in the United States for all practical purposes.
Yes.
2017 came around. We're like, okay, see this QR thing coming on the iPhone. Let's try doing payments with QRs. That went over like a lead balloon as well, like less than 3% maybe participated. And that was usually with us cajoling and teaching and signs and stuff like that. So really not a lot of participation. And then simultaneously, because the first brewery was doing well, we got approached by a developer here in the Washington area. And they said, hey, would you be interested in building another brewery in this area to call the Mosaic District. And we figured out a deal for an old warehouse over there. Mm-hmm. And so we ended up financing, okay, well, the first one worked and it's making money. So let's go to the second one. So that's all happening. I'm getting more and more intrigued by this GoTab problem and spending probably at 100% of my time there, but also opening a second brewery, which opened its doors in 2018. So that was a much larger restaurant. It's 6,000 feet indoors, but it's actually 3 stories tall.
Oh, wow.
So it's a 6,000 foot plate. And then we added in some other floors. So it nets out probably over 6,000 of dining area. And then you also have another 4,000 of patio space. So about 10,000 square foot.
It's like it's a full venue.
it is. It used to be a United Rentals warehouse, so a heavy equipment warehouse. So it's 50, 60 foot ceilings, just a huge, massive metal box. Just a really funny anecdote that any restaurateur would love. We once got a review on Yelp that someone says something to the effect of like, they really did a crappy job of making this place look old and crappy. So it actually is old and crappy.
It's actually that was we weren't going for that.
Like we didn't do jack to make it old and crappy. We actually made it as nice as you could with this 50-year-old warehouse. So it was a known area. It was this one sort of like last warehouse for this developer that they didn't tear down. And so we turned it into this cool brewery. But we also knew based on our first brewery, because we were, I think, one of the first breweries in Fairfax County. So we had to fight through all kinds of laws to get open. Mm-hmm. That we were going to have lines out the door because there just were no breweries around at the time.
Wow.
So we're like, crap, how are we going to do this? We got three stories of dining area. We got outdoor patio. We're almost certainly just going to get buried in lines. And that the last, like the day before, we had started building this QR ordering. Mm-hmm. I should back up. At GoTab in 2017, we saw like QR payments isn't really going. I really wonder if we could do QR ordering like they do in China, because we've been studying what's going on in the rest of the world, and looking at where people were going with QRs, and said, well, hey, QRs are here now that they're supporting the iPhone. So what does the rest of the world use them for? And so we were looking at WeChat and Alipay and a lot of the stuff that goes on in Asia. And so we said, you know, maybe people avoid lines and order from QRs like they do over there. Simultaneously, the brewery opened its doors in 2018. And like the week before, we finished our QR ordering product. And then we decided to simultaneously go cashless, because we're like, I don't even know how we're going to manage cash in this place with lines piled up. So we went cashless. We deployed QRs.
What year was this cashless?
2018.
And there's nothing in Virginia that prevented you from doing that?
It's still cashless. So if there is,
I wish. You're talking about the biggest goal. I wish.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nothing is worse than going to a brick and mortar bank. This is 1970.
It's amazing how much,
like the amount of time and effort. It's like we literally, as restaurant owners, become a mini bank. We go to the bank to make change, and then we come back, and then the customer hands us money to make change for them. It's like this stupid cycle. It's so stupid.
It's amazing how much of that cash just manages to disappear between one place and the next. It's funny. It's just anecdote. I deal with operators who really want to do more and more cash. And I'm like, you do know that I know you think you're saving money from giving it to the government.
Yeah.
But I can assure you, your employees are saving a lot of money from making its way to your hands.
That's correct.
I'm pretty sure the net is negative.
Yeah.
Yeah. So 2018, we opened our doors in October. We had QRs on the table as a very last minute, like, hey, let's see if this thing works as a way to like abate the lines. And because with both, I basically spent the next 3 days for 12 hours a day, because we were open starting in the morning. It was a breakfast, lunch, dinner till 1 a.m.
Of course, so you were.
coffee at 8.
Because you didn't have enough going on. You got to do four meal services.
Right. Yeah. It was crazy.
Why not just 24 hours? I mean, why even close?
It was pretty close. It was 7 a.m. till 1 a.m. Yeah.
We did that. We were 7 a.m. till, I think we only got till midnight, but that was,
It's still 7 a.m., but it closes at 11 p.m. because COVID
basically
did that all in. But anyway, so I stood there for 12 hours, 3 days in a row, and tried to see what the uptake was firsthand on QR ordering. And so I walked up and down the line and would start like, I hate to say it, start profiling people like, okay, can I get this kid to go order from a QR? Can I get this old guy to go order from QR? Quickly learned a whole bunch about the demographics of, you know, who would change their patterns, what habits people were inclined to. Mm-hmm. It was really easy to peel like the 20-year-olds off and say, hey, you know, you can skip this whole line if you go to that table and order in that QR. And mind you, no one's ever seen this. And in 2018, there were exactly two companies doing this in the United States. One was us and the other was Bebot. Mm-hmm. That's essentially what we rolled out. We would see, and I actually have time-lapse videos from back then. We would see that about 60% of all volume on a Friday and Saturday night when there was a big line would go to the QR on the table.
It's amazing.
And again, this is 2018. People thought we were totally nuts, but it worked. It worked here because we had these lines and people like me don't like lines. And so if they can go sit at a table, They will go sit at a table and order on the phone.
Why? So let's talk about lines, because it's an obsession of mine. And I talk to restaurant owners, and not just restaurant owners, but business owners all the time. And just the psychology behind lines. And when you think, not just in the restaurant business, but when you go to Walmart or you go to Home Depot, or now you go to the airlines, you know, the kiosk, and what the kiosk has allowed people to, if you want to use technology, you can skip the line. If you want to talk to a human, it's going to be more expensive and it's going to take you more time. Can you bring me inside the psychology of when you were doing those tests, when you were there for 12 hours, what were you seeing as far as a willingness? Because when I think of technology, I think of courage and a willingness to look stupid. And I think about myself, you know, when I think about how long it took me to put a credit card on my Apple phone to do Apple Pay, I try to figure out, why did it take me so long? And the reason it took me a long time, because I didn't want to be the idiot in line holding up the rest of the line trying to do Apple Pay.
Yep.
When I did it, and then now I use Apple Pay, I don't want to use anything else.
Yep.
Can you talk to me about the psychology behind you personally, but you're a technologist. You're different. Yeah. You're in a different class. Well, but the people around you.
Well, so let me be a little clearer. So my prior business was user experience design. So it was half design and half technology. So a lot of our staff, we would design interfaces, and we think about, like, how would people see those interfaces? And read lots of books and theories and such, and studied it and ran labs. So as much as I am a software guy, I also spend a lot of time reading and thinking about usability.
Yes.
I would say the thing that I learned from the very first efforts of GoTab to the later efforts around QR ordering was that the only real motivator for changing human behavior is pain avoidance.
Yes.
That's the only way to get people to do stuff. Incentives do not work unless they're, like, outrageously big, and no one can afford that, right? But if there's pain avoidance, absolutely people will figure out how to do it. So, like, we tried prior, like, incentives and discounts and all kinds of stuff to get people to do this stuff, but a big ass line that's going to keep you 20 minutes away from your beer, well, that's an incentive. That's a real move that will change habit. And so that's probably priority number one. Whenever I think of, can I change habits? The question is, like, where is the pain, and where is that pain that I can use to change those habits? So I don't know if that answered your question, but that's something I always think about, is, like, if there's no pain, there's no way you're going to get people to adopt something. You maybe will get some fringe people. And really those are going to be people who are or basically find financial compensation to be worth it. But most people find, you know, peripheral financial incentive not to be enough to change their habits. And the people who candidly find it compelling are usually the ones who are so poor that they're not going to come spend a lot of money at your place anyway. I guess that's how I always think of these habit forming changes. But I will tell you, I observed a lot of stereotypes, that some were true and some were not, they're different from what I expected. Yeah. Certainly just to be totally blunt, there was definitely an age correlation. Like, younger people were happy to do it, older people were less so. One of the ones that I found very surprising was a lot of the older women were actually super interested in learning how to do it.
That's interesting.
So it was not uncommon to see a guy with a broken old Android phone that basically only used for phone calls who said hell no to me, and a wife who pulls out her iPhone and she's like, I want to do it. And then I had that happen at least 3 or 4 times, you know, a day. Which the contrast was always funny, because you're like, okay, same age, different gender, very different response. So, you know, you never quite know. And I hate to stereotype, but when you do this for a profession, you start observing these trends.
Can you bring me into the psychology of the difference in smartphone users from an Android user to an Apple user?
Well, I can tell you, my old business where we would design these interfaces, it's not even a psychology thing. It's household income. iPhone users have more purchasing power. So when we were designing applications in the United States, if you were trying to make money, if that was your primary goal, then you'd release on the iPhone first because the iPhone users had higher purchasing power. So certainly you're going to go there first. It changes if you get outside the US. Android is the dominant platform outside the US. And so you have very different demographics of the devices. But in the US, if you know, that's why QR has never worked. And so many people prior to 2017 rationally said, you know, QR suck, but it actually wasn't the QRs, it was actually the iPhone. And because the iPhone is 60% of the market in the US, and because it didn't have it built in, QRs did suck because our primary device just didn't do it.
Yep. You said 60%. Is that what it is? 60%?
Yeah. Yep. Correct. Yeah.
Wow.
Sorry. Just get that glare out.
And what percentage of people have a smartphone device? Is there a percentage of people that don't have a connected, that have a phone that's not connected?
No, it's actually, so that this is another, this is probably dated information, but I can tell you it probably still holds true. Is that even people without a household internet connection, so like relative, like something that's relatively expensive,
yes,
$50, $80, another $100 a month for your high speed internet connection, will have a smartphone.
Wow.
And the reason is because if you think about the utility of a smartphone, I mean, it's massive. Just think about how much time saves being able to text and get directions and all these things. It like the smartphone is arguably more valuable than many other things in your life, more valuable than a car, even like knowing what bus to take is thanks to you having your smartphone, right? So
I mean, we talk about it all the time. I would rather get stuck and lose my keys as opposed to lose my smartphone. If I have my smartphone, I can do anything.
Right.
If I don't have my keys, I mean, if I lose my keys, like, okay, I need to figure out how to get a ride. But like the two things that I always take, it's like my wallet and even my wallet. The wallet is going here. I mean, like literally,
Yeah,
the wallet is going inside of the, so
I mean,
the fact that I'm even carrying. Yeah. I mean, the fact that it's, do you carry a wallet or do you just keep that?
Mine's got the, you know, the requisite two cards on the back. And after that, that's it. And that's only because not everything supports, you know, Apple Pay.
Yep. So.
Inconveniences too.
So building GoTab, is there any story or lesson of something that you would have done differently? Something that went wrong looking back? I mean, obviously you can't predict a pandemic, but when you're scaling a company, and something that you believe in, not only from a technology standpoint, but from an operations standpoint. I mean, you're like, listen, dude, it works for me. It'll work for you.
Candidly, I would have been wrong had COVID not hit. I don't know that I would have had the staying power, the extra 3-4 years it would have taken for the US to adopt QRs.
Yeah.
Let's put it this way. I've started 7 companies in my life.
Mm-hmm.
For the most part, I've been correct on, you know, the market wanting this solution.
Yeah.
But I've also shut down 2 of them because the market didn't want the solution until 5 years after I, you know, tried to assemble it. So the reality is that, you know, sometimes you can be too early. And in this case, I think I probably was too early, had COVID not hit. And so I'm not so naive or whatever to believe that it was super smart. I was maybe reasonably smart and hell of a lot of luck.
Yeah. How many employees do you guys have? Where are you at?
We're about 85 right now.
85. Amazing.
Yeah.
When you're growing, what do you think is how are you gaining traction? How are you converting people because the way that I see it, we always say on the show, stay curious, get involved, ask for help. You know, mm-hmm. It takes a curiosity. You have to believe in the internet. You have to believe in digital hospitality, what we talk about all the time. In real life, we're phenomenal. You can't be in business unless you have hospitality in your DNA. It's just how do you use technology to be better online and to be better omnichannel? And you got to partner with technology companies that understand what's going on. You know, I had Noah Glass, the founder of Olo, on the show, and he talks about this smartphone, content, commerce, communication.
Yep.
Content, commerce, communication. But we think, oh, well, I'm going to open up a restaurant and people are just going to come to my restaurant. That's what I thought. naively in 2008 in a terrible location. I thought, hey, if we have phenomenal barbecue, people are going to come from all over San Diego, come and give us money. And then the legacy media, newspapers, everyone's going to write about us. We're going to have lines and it's going to be phenomenal. No, didn't happen. Yeah. So for you, how do you think about that?
So it's funny. I feel like our business is bifurcating in some ways to businesses who want to stay low digital, at least from a consumer perspective.
Interesting.
So we actually have a number of deals where the operators have almost no guest facing technology. That really? Doesn't mean there isn't a lot of tech going on behind the scenes in terms of how we run the kitchen or what the POS does, or there's a lot of things that we're doing that really raise the efficiency of the ordering, communication, production awareness within the restaurant. So if you think about it, like, here's a really simple, dumb example. I run out of, you know, let's pick something stupid. Let's just say I run out of some appetizer, right? In a low-tech restaurant, or actually a fairly typical restaurant, when I 86 it, first off, who's the person who can 86 it? And you tell me. Let's say you run out of French fries.
Yeah.
You shouldn't, but yeah. your chef knows, or your fry cook knows, right? So how do they take it off the menu?
they have to tell someone.
Yeah, so they have to go find someone. They have to leave Expo.
Yeah.
Run up front, find a manager.
Yep.
Presumably who has access to log into the POS. So how much time?
Presumably.
Yeah, presumably. And meanwhile, you got orders still coming in digitally, and you got orders still coming in from handheld servers walking around your restaurant.
Yep.
Who don't know that you're out of fries. So that's a problem. Now you've got how many fries? If you're a high volume place, because we actually started in high volume, right? The first restaurant we started was a 10,000 square foot restaurant that was selling thousands of beers a day.
Yeah.
If you sell 20 beers that you don't have, that's 20 conversations you now have to have.
Yes.
And you also have to still go tell all your staff, hey, by the way, we're out of that beer. We're out of those French fries. That's a lot of work. And it's always a lot of work.
And you got to comp it off.
And it's the worst time, the worst possible time that this always happens, right? Or at least that's what it always feels like. So I would say, like, one of the things we do is you can 86, you can set stock levels, and you can set delays on an individual item directly from Expo. So your chef knows, boom. 86 the fries directly from that item on the kitchen. I can also then message all the subsequent or later guests if we are digital. But if we're not digital, I can also push it to all the handheld POSs. So all the staff out on the floor is like, oh, shoot, I just sold a French fry. I need to go tell, you know, those guests over at that table, because maybe we're not ordering from QRs. Maybe we're not doing online ordering. And maybe we don't want the guests to know we do have technical underpinnings. So the question is, what is that guest experience supposed to be? Mm-hmm. I mean, because I'll say it, I was somewhere the other day and I was like, I really don't want to pick up my phone, right?
Yeah.
And that's nice sometimes to have that option.
Yep.
Then on the flip side, you know, if it's a high volume environment, I know I can't be catered to. I know someone's not going to walk out and take my order. It's not practical. So then I use my phone or, you know, maybe our voices in the future. Yes. So I just look at all these different environments, but I think there's a lot of tech that can be applied to increase the efficiency, to increase the ease of use for the experience, even for the staff, because it's a lot less chaos.
Yeah. What gets you excited about the future of what you're building?
I actually get very excited about guests being comfortable having a digital relationship with the restaurant or with a brand, so that, you know, they text message Cali Barbecue and say, I want to have my sandwich ready at 2.
Yep.
You say, great. That's with pickles and mustard, right?
Correct.
And they're like, yep, great. So the fact that you have a continuous, you know, experience with them, whether it's over text or voice or online or whatever, and you already have that, so you can save them the effort. It's funny. I think in hospitality, people are like, "Oh, it's creepy." I'm like, "That's not creepy. That's what Amazon does every single freaking day."
Absolutely. Yep.
So why, and especially in an industry that aspires to know its guests, it seems a bit ironic to me that they're saying, "Why wouldn't you tell the guest, hey, this is what you ordered last time, or this is a slight variation, or guess what?" here's a new item you haven't seen because we know the last time you were in. I think that stuff gets me really excited because as a consumer, I want it. And that's how I think of a lot of these things. You know, I want these solutions. I want them fast. I want them predictable. I want quality maintained. And so that's what gets me excited, both as a consumer and an engineer.
When you think of digital hospitality, what are the brands that you admire?
Huh. Boy, I should have thought about that question before this. you mentioned Olo. I mean, I think Olo did and I just saw them present at a conference. I think they cut a pretty good path. I mean, they arguably were too early to the market.
Very early.
That also established their, you know, it also established their strength.
Yes.
And I think, you know, kudos to them for seeing that there was going to be a problem here. Also lucky for them, the market realized they were right to some degree, and they found a path to really move forward with that. And, you know, I think that's someone's going to be first, and hopefully I always think of the bleeding edge and the leading edge. They were probably the bleeding edge for a while. Hopefully they're the leading edge now. I do find it curious that Noah keeps talking about QRs in his presentations. And I'm like, why are you talking? Maybe you know the secret to that, but.
Well, yeah. Tell me about QRs. What do you think? I mean, you know, we live in the space. We have order and pay, and, you know, we use Toast in our restaurant, and I talk about QR codes all the time. And I was actually, you know, back in the day before the Apple update, I was the one that was like, QR codes are dumb because no one's going to download an app to actually use a QR code. And sure enough, Apple makes the update and it changes everything, and the pandemic hits. But I mean, where do you see QR codes? What is it going to look like?
Well, I mean, I do think in a lot of ways, QR codes are dumb. That's actually one of the best reasons that they have longevity. Because they are
a good point.
I mean, what people don't realize, and I heard someone sort of misconstrue what QR codes can do. You see them implement so badly all the time with just a QR code to a menu.
Yeah.
And I'm like, to a PDF menu, and I'm going, I actually had an operator say, oh, we put QRs on the tables and we saw our sales go down because we took away the menus, we had QRs. And I dug in and they're like, yeah, they had a static PDF menu. I'm like, well, you just gave people a really shitty menu experience. Like, you give them a little window to look at a not useful. So anyway, I think QR codes are a tool, a technology. I think a lot of people don't understand that each QR code that we deploy is different. Almost every single one is unique. And that lets us know where they are in space. That lets us know who passed it to you. That lets us know what tab that's related to. And I think that, you know, whether it's a QR, the next generation is going to be NFC because there's a chip equivalent of it that's a little slicker from a consumer. You just tap it. It's the same way that the cards on card readers work. Or there's some other solution I've been looking at. There's some Bluetooth indoor positioning tech that's sort of coming out. I think, you know, there's going to be some way where we can position things in space and understand what the consumer attached or the user attached to a device, where they are and what they want. So I think QRs are just the step toward that. I will say the thing they have that going for them is they're basically free because there's no patent, because there's no technology to buy, and you print them on your stupid printer. And that's, you know, one thing we learned on the internet is like HTML was a free standard and it sucked in a lot of ways. And we're still using HTML.
Yes.
So I don't know. I don't think they're going away anytime soon. I would love for them to be a little more clever and a little cleaner and a little less clunky. And I think we'll get there in terms of how we engage with them, not having to scan the camera and fidget around and all that so much. But I do think they're going to be around for a while.
Do you have any mentors or a story of a mentor, something that kind of changed your trajectory of what you're building?
Man, my mentor is reality punching me in the face more often than
not. It's a good mentor.
Let's see here. There are definitely a lot of people I think I read more than I get to you know these people, unfortunately. Yep. Like, I'm a big fan of Jeff Raskin. He wrote a book called The Humane Interface. He was the original designer of the Mac interface. I found his book to be really compelling. Mm-hmm. I read a lot of behavioral economics. So all the like anomalies that make up humans. So that would be, I don't know, all kinds of, I'm going to blank on all the names now that I'm on the podcast, but my brother's an economist. So we're frequently, discussing human behavior, either yes. at a statistical level or a psychological level. I think I read a lot. I wish I've had mentors, but unfortunately I started out at Lockheed Martin at my first job and quit within 3 weeks.
Oh, wow.
Put me in the wrong job, and then essentially ended up being an entrepreneur from there on out. So I've never had a lot of luxury of having, you know, people who've been down the road. And I'm also based on the East Coast. Being on the East Coast in the tech business and not being in the government business in the DC area is also kind of puts you in a weird spot. Now I'm in the hospitality business in DC. Hospitality res tech or whatever this is. So I don't know.
Yeah, that's actually one of my favorite questions. What business are you in?
I'm in the restaurant technology. I actually look at it larger. I look at it as e-commerce, but yep. Everybody in the restaurant world thinks that's weird, and they think I'm speaking in terms of shipping boxes from Amazon.
I don't think that's weird at all. And I think I don't think not just restaurant owners, every small business owner from a coffee shop to a lemonade stand. I mean, we all need to have these principles in our business. Yeah. That's the essence of digital hospitality.
Yep.
If you're not doing it like the e-commerce companies, then what are we doing?
I agree. It just doesn't resonate with a lot of people. In fact, like if you went back to our early pitch decks for GoTab, we said we were e-commerce for the real world. And what I meant by that was like, you're in a physical space together. Yep. You should be able to do e-commerce conveniently. Right now, e-commerce is very oriented towards boxes in different locations. And that did not resonate with anybody, along with all the other QR ideas I had. And
resonates with me. I should have got the pitch deck. It resonates with me.
Yeah, cool.
So every Wednesday and every Friday, for those of you that are listening, we like to say, like we said, stay curious, get involved, ask for help. But we do rooms on the social audio app Clubhouse. So Wednesdays, Fridays, 10 a.m. Pacific time, 1 p.m. Eastern time. We've got some incredible digital hospitality leaders. We talk about sales. We talk about marketing. We talk about entrepreneurship, restaurants, content creation. We are all in the creator business. You all need to be your own media company, hence Cali Barbecue Media. But one of the things I'd love for you to do, Tim, is let me know who's a shout out for somebody on your team, somebody that's gone above and beyond. It's hard as and when we're in the hospitality space, even in the restaurant space, we don't do a good job of taking care of ourselves. That's one of the things we talk about a lot on this show is, I have to be better as a dad. I have to be better as a husband. If I'm ever going to be better as a leader, as a podcaster, as a restaurant owner, anything like that. But for you, is there anybody that you'd like to give a shout out to? And then the second question is, what do you do for self-care besides biking?
I would definitely shout out to Dariush Mansouri, my co-founder. You said I was a founder. He actually was equally, founder back in the day. He came over from my first business. In fact, my leadership team is all four of the executive people are from my original business. Site World. Wow. But Dariush was crazy enough to jump in this boat with me and at the very beginning. And he is the pillar upon which we were built. So if we wouldn't be where we are, if he weren't making it happen too.
And self-care.
I would say I do as much as I can physically because that's how I stay good mentally. I played soccer yesterday. You know, I'll go biking, or I'm actually going for a bike ride after this, which is why I'm doing the casual wear.
There we go.
So I would say that's a big part of it for me is, you know, maybe shouldn't say this, but I play soccer on Sunday mornings and my wife used to go to church and I was like, well, my church is the soccer field. That's how my head gets clear. It really makes me feel a lot better if I can get out and, you know, connect a great shot with some people and have fun.
Absolutely. And where can people learn more about GoTab?
Our website has a lot on it. Although honestly, there's so many weird things that we do, I would say get a demo if you want to actually know, because even like the 86ing, all the stuff I touched, that's like one of 40 things that we do that nobody else in the industry does. So demos, you'll probably learn it because you kind of need to see it in motion. So if you wanted the detail, get a demo, but the website will have a lot of information at gotab.com.
And then is GoTab going to have a presence at any of the big industry trade shows, or how do you feel about trade shows? Because we're trying to revolutionize. They need to be better, in our opinion. There are good ones out there, but they definitely could be better.
We spent a lot of money on trade shows over the last year. We're going to spend less money this year because a lot of them weren't worth it.
Yep.
There are some specific ones that are worth it for us in our business in particular. But it's probably 30% of the ones we went to last year, maybe 40. There's definitely got to be a better way. Our biggest challenge with our product is getting in front of people.
Yep.
Because you've got, you know, the very large multi-billion dollar publicly traded companies. Mm-hmm. And we believe we have a better mousetrap, at least for some certain for a lot of cases. But if we don't even get a chance to swing at it, people just buy the default. And it's a hard problem. That's actually maybe the bigger problem we're facing now, is like getting market awareness without spending $1 billion.
Yep. Well, it's a challenge for all of us, but we, as we say on the show, we believe in storytelling, and you coming on here and sharing your expertise and what you're building, why you're building it. It means a lot to us and to our audience. So thank you, Tim, for your leadership. If you guys want to get in touch with me, it's at Sean P. Walchef, SHAWNPWALCHEF. That is on Instagram, LinkedIn, TikTok, Twitter, Facebook, all the platforms. Please join us on Clubhouse. Please go check out GoTab. And Tim, we really appreciate your time, and we'll catch you guys all next week. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sean. Cheers.